Let's bring Big Matt in. Welcome to the show. Good to see you, Matt. What's up?
What's good, man?
Chilling, man. A lot going on. I saw you at Bronco practice yesterday. God damn it. Last year, you and I sat here, and I picked Russell Weirdo to lead the Broncos to a surprising attack and have a great season. And Patrick got hurt. This year, I said, there's no way they can do it 2 years in a row. He cannot fail 2 years in a row under Sean Payton's new deal. And then Patrick blows his Achilles yesterday. Hamler gets released for a heart ailment. And now they're back to Jerry Jeudy and the other guy, Sutton. Who you can argue two of them are unproven. They're very great talents. But, Jeudy hasn't really got off the schneid, so to speak, yet and proven to anybody that he's great. I think you've even said that. Where are we at in Denver? How you feeling the vibe? Are they still a very, very good team? And I know their roster. I still put their roster second or third in that conference right now from top to bottom, offense and defense speaking.
Look, the defensive secondary is elite. The defensive secondary is unbelievable. They are going to give people problems this year. I would imagine the Broncos will have a top five overall defense, especially if they're healthy and Gregory and Clark and, you know, all these guys can actually pressure the passer and stay on the field. If that happens, I mean, the secondary is going to have so many tip balls and so many picks and so many opportunities for big plays. The defense is real, real, real. The offense is, how do I say this? Russell Wilson leads the offense. So yesterday was not good, to say the least. And I'm not trying to be negative. It just is. I mean, they were 11 3-by-1 to the left. Isolated backside, rolled the coverage all the way over, single high safety, cover one, backside corner bailed at the snap of the ball. It's an easy 10-yard completion, just a hitch. And he airmailed it like 12 yards to the left of the receiver. He had to jump, totally missed everything. Ball flew out of bounds. It's like he shot put the ball at him. I don't know what he threw another pick yesterday. He just looked slow with his release. He looked slow with his computing. He's not in there like dissecting everything. He's not seeing it before it happens. It's like an under front with a Sam stack that could look like odd, but it's obviously under. And safety rotation on a 12-year pro is confusing now. I just don't understand what I'm saying.
I saw Dak Prescott do it. Me and Spinny and I broke it down yesterday. He throws a pick just by thinking that the two eye safety, he's just looking over here and just fucking throws it over here and it's picked by the two eye safety that never moved. And I'm like, you're a 9-year vet, bro. Like, what's going on? Like,
that's my thing is, these guys are watching tape all day and studying what the hell is going on here. I mean, this is vanilla elementary shit that they're struggling with. I understand that Russ is getting a new system, but I mean, come on, bro. An over front, an under front, even odd and bare, that's all they can run up front, and or combo fronts that will just game plan to and just full slide. Like, this is not that fucking hard, and I'm tired of like this. Well, he's learning a new system, give him time. Like, he's been in the league for 13 years and has $200 million in the bank. This guy should know how to do all of this. It should be like clockwork. He should go out and be like, oh, I got it, and just bop, bop, bop down the field and do your job. I think the Broncos are in store for the same exact kind of season they had last year. Same exact kind. Like, I think that they are going to be really good on defense. I think they're going to run the shit out of the ball, and people are going to start stacking the box, and Russ is not going to be able to hit throws down the field. He just lost his best target again in Tim Patrick for the second year in a row. Jerry Jeudy is a soft-boned turd, bro. That guy does not.
People keep talking about me being wrong about Patrick. They're like, he's a third guy. You guys have no fucking clue what you're talking about. Look, Shut up.
He is their best football player, but their third best receiver, if that makes sense. Mm. He's their best football player that plays receiver. He's their glue guy. He's their third down weapon. If you're criticizing this like it doesn't mean anything, it means a ton.
These guys don't know football, man.
He's a massively important part to this football team. So
they don't know that Patrick opens up the fucking Judy 9 route and the seam inside and the rail route. You have no fucking clue what you're talking about in the chat.
If they had all three of their good receivers, then it would open up a lot of different possibilities in the route combination. Now they have to put a rookie in there in Mims and hope that he can just kind of be the same kind of guy that an 8-year vet is, and it's just not going to happen. So I don't know, man. Taking away Patrick again from Russ is a big loss. I will say this. He's never really had him, so are you really taking him away because he didn't play last year either? It's not like Russell still doesn't have weapons, though. He's got Dolchitz and Judy and Sutton and Javonte Williams. There's plenty of guys to get the ball to. The problem is Jared Stidham looks more comfortable in the pocket and looks more comfortable delivering the football and looks more comfortable leading than Russ. I think Russ can feel every eye on him. I think he can feel the pressure. I think he's trying to press. I think he's trying to do too much. And now it's like in reverse. Last year, he was doing too much on social media and doing too much off the field, and now he's trying to do too much on the field. Like, at some point, Russ has just got to walk the line down the middle and just be him. Like, always trying to put on a facade of who you are to prove someone's point. It's probably not the best way to be. And I don't know if we've ever really seen the real Russell Wilson. I wonder what he's really like, because it's like he's so fake that it's like rolling over into every aspect of his life. So now he's being fake enthusiastic quarterback at practice, and he's being fake leader at practice, and he's being fake nice guy with the media. And last year he was like too cool for school and didn't want anything to do with anybody, and he had his parent or his family walking around the goddamn facility and his coach next door to him in his office, and now he's just a regular guy again. So it's this up and down shit with the Broncos and Russell Wilson. I think this is the last year of it. I don't think that Sean Payton will want to deal with this moving forward, and the first time that he gets an opportunity to get rid of Russ, if Russ struggles, which I think he's going to, I think he's going to get replaced pretty quick.
Where are you at? Segue-wise, I know Smitty has some stuff for you. Where are you at with the Sean Payton comments and the Hackett comments coming back yesterday about the glass house coaching business that we all live in? Agree, disagree. Where are you at with the whole Sean Payton deal? I can give you the coach's perspective after you give me your take.
Okay. As a player for both teams that played for the Jets and Broncos, I'm loving this. This game is going to be incredible.
I didn't think about that.
Smacking the shit out of each other in this game. Hopefully we get refs that aren't flag happy, because that's going to be a hell of a football game unless they destroy it with the refs. All that said, though, Sean Payton didn't say anything that wasn't true, but I don't know if he should be saying that in the media. But again, it's a breath of fresh air. I don't have a problem with it at all. Like, Hackett was fucking terrible. He was absolutely atrocious. He had no idea what he was doing. He cost the Broncos a year. He may have ruined Russell Wilson. You know, he destroyed a team where if they score 18 points a game, they win 12 games. Like, that gives me hope that they can figure it out, but Russell's still the quarterback. So I just think Hackett and the Jets, you know, Aaron Rodgers is coming to the defense of his boy, and he should. I think that this is a nice little rivalry, and the NFL loves this. This is more drama. I'm not like unaware of the fact that the Jets are on Hard Knocks, and this is going to be a way for people to go watch the show. Like, I wouldn't be surprised if this is all fabricated.
That's a good point.
Here's my side of it. I've done this before. I've replaced shitty ass coaches that have ruined programs. I've had to take over and build a weight room in a coach's office, and I've seen just shitty fucking underwear and trash cans and everything all over the place. I've replaced places. I use it as fuel to the fire to my new players and current and old players. I would say, what the fuck did this slapdick tell you last year? What the fuck did these slapdicks do to you last year? I would use it to get those guys on my side. That is what Sean Payton did. A little bit. I think he got troops rallied up in his locker room, in his new, you know, this culture revision that he's creating. Now, taking it public, though, I don't know. Two things, Big Matt, you know, and I know. We're ready to face you in the eye, look you in the eye and face adversity. And we're looking to tell you, if we're going to call out a bitch and call you a bitch, we're going to do it in person because we probably don't like you or respect you very much.
Exactly.
You could say Sean Payton's like, fuck you. Fuck I don't you, respect bitch. You or like you, fuck so I'm telling you.
Yeah, fuck you.
That's how I look at it.
And look, that's a missing part of manhood now in society. Now you tell a man, fuck you, you're a bitch. And they're like, you're right. Fuck me. I am a bitch.
No, because it's on Twitter. Right? It's on Twitter, and they laugh. Right. They give you the laugh emoji afterwards.
Yeah. Well, hold on. I'm talking about like face-to-face contact or, you know, him calling out somebody in the media. Unfortunately, the world we live in, especially you, there's Twitter tough guys everywhere, and their thumbs are their fists. And they sit there all day, and they've got Code Red Mountain Dew and Cheeto-covered fingers, and they're just banging away on their computer. Probably haven't touched a vagina in 20 years. I mean, fuck, man. Forgot what it smells like. Forgot what it tastes like. Forgot what it feels like. Now they're all pissed off. Their hand's not doing the job. The Twitter tough guys out here, you guys are fucking ridiculous, Doug. I mean, one minute you're sucking him off and oh, you know everything, coach. And then the next minute he's a fucking asshole because he doesn't agree with you. Like, look, man, there's lots of different opinions here, and the fan's opinion doesn't count. Buy your ticket, drink your beer, wear your jersey, shut the fuck up, and we'll try and win a game for you. We're here to play this game. It's our livelihood. It's your entertainment. You might as well be watching a movie. I don't care if you don't like it either. Oh, he's a smug ex-athlete. You're right. I'm smug. I am an ex-athlete. I have my NFL pension. This is how I feel. I think the fans that sit in the crowd and yell, I could do that. You can't walk that guy. I think you're a fucking moron, and I'd like to rip your heart out of your chest. But I can't. I just say I want to. And that's the difference is I will tell you you're a bitch to your face quick, and you won't do shit about it, but you'll get on fucking Twitter and type that I'm a bitch. And that's cool because it just tells me who you really are.
Hey, he dropping gems. Matt ain't playing around today. Matt is not playing around today. Let me ask you this real quick, because you said something about Russ. In response to the whole Hackett and the back and forth with Sean Payton, if Russell Wilson does have another bad season this year, are we blaming Russell Wilson, or are we going to blame Nathaniel Hackett for ruining Russell Wilson?
No, it's Russ's fault. Period. Gotcha.
Okay.
I mean, come on. He's had so many different coaches. This is not the first time he's had to deal with a bad coach. I mean, he had Brian Schottenheimer as an offensive coordinator. I've had Brian Schottenheimer as an offensive coordinator. He threw 40 touchdowns with Shoddy. And Shoddy's not the best OC in the world. He's not the worst, but he ain't the best. You know, people would probably say Hackett's probably better than Shoddy. I don't know if I'd agree with that. Just because Hackett's got Aaron Rodgers under his belt. So, look, and I really mean under his belt. Like, Aaron Rodgers is blowing Nathaniel Hackett right now, trying to figure out, like, how to support him. He's under his belt all fucking day, just cradling the balls right now. And he should be, because his coach is getting eviscerated, and it's all fucking true. Like, there's nothing that Sean Payton's saying that isn't true. So I don't have a problem with it. I wish more teams did it. I wish it was more of a shit-talking – I wish there was more of a shit-talking WWE aspect to this. Not right. Like the, you don't need to like make a mockery coming out to like go play the game like the WWE does. But I do wish that there would be more teams that gave bulletin board material. I love it when teams don't like each other and they let it be known. That's a good thing. Yep. It's a good thing. I don't think it's a bad thing. The fact that like Hackett last year wouldn't, like, say to Broncos country that the Raiders are a major rival. He would say things like, my dad used to coach for him. It's a great organization. I love that place. It's awesome. And he's talking about the Raiders and he's a Broncos head coach. It's like, bro, do you not fucking understand where you are? That's not the way this rolls here. That's right. Blasphemy. This is Broncos country. That's the fucking
jersey swapping.
Exactly. What did he just say?
He said, fuck jersey swapping out of nowhere, man. I don't know where it came from. I don't know if Debbie got Tourette's. I don't know what that came. That was crazy.
That big, big purple vagina.
Hey, man, I love hot Cheetos.
Hey, man, I just fucking hate the jersey swap after the game, dog. Fuck that shit.
You don't like the jersey swap?
Fuck no. Swap that jersey when you fucking retire, and I'll call you in 10 years. Give me your fucking jersey then.
I do like it when guys bring me jerseys, but I never did a jersey swap on the field.
I want to beat the fuck out of you for this next 5 or 6 years I'm in the league. Fuck your jersey. Hey, Matt, I gotta ask you, Matt. I don't know if this is real or not, Matt, but is this the world we're coming to? Is this the fucking world we're in?
This got to be fake. Please be fake.
Please be fake. I saw this, too. Please fucking God be fake.
Is this real or not? Hey, Ethan.
I don't know if it's real.
Ethan, Google this. Ethan, do some research, Ethan. See if this is real or not.
JB, I Googled it this morning, and the only thing I've been seeing is that he was dismissed from the team, and he transferred over to, was it Ole Miss? He transferred somewhere, but he no one.
To Ole Miss, take some more dick pics.
I think it was Ole Miss. Correct me if I'm wrong, Ethan, but I've not confirmed if it's real or not.
A buddy of mine at the four-year level, he's saying that it's real.
So just think about this real quick.
Look, it's real, dog.
Yeah, it is real. This fucking kid is a pervert. So this kid is sitting in his locker with his fucking cell phone in the locker room with a bunch of dudes, a bunch of hairy ass dudes, and he's just sitting there filming them going, oh, yeah, look at the offensive lineman's ass right there. Look at the zit on his ass. It's about to pop. Oh, yeah, he's so fucking set. He's going in the shower. He's going to soap that ass up. I know he is. I can't wait to go home and load this and beat my meat to it. This fucking kid's a weirdo.
All right, let me time out.
You weird motherfucker. What's wrong with you? This kid's
let me beat this kid
right now. Motherfucker, you better erase my pictures off your phone, you fucking weirdo.
Here's my let me get some perspective. This is what I understand.
Crush, bro.
I'm understanding this is what has happened. He's taking pictures of guys in the locker room that's just not naked or anything, just dudes in the locker room on his team, selling them to his OnlyFans page for women to purchase. They're not naked, they're not crazy or nothing. I don't believe he's even that way. Yeah, just like he's doing it to women. So he's selling it to women on his OnlyFans as here's the players at Clemson. Here's the guys you're fans of. Blah, 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 blah.
And, wait a second. So you're telling me he's not selling soapy ass pictures?
No, it's not soapy ass. It's just regular fucking like weird ass.
That's in my head. Fuck.
Yeah, it's in your head. It's in your head. It's in your head, dude. Unnecessary roughness. Yeah,
Matt said, hold on, so wait. You're telling me.
All right, so why is he getting suspended if he's just taking pictures of his friends?
He probably didn't ask him, so he's probably just like speaking of pictures.
For monetary use, apparently, and he's not asking anybody.
So you're telling me I could just take a headshot of all the fucking dummies that walk through my door and sell it on OnlyFans and some weird fat chick in Kansas is going to buy it?
If we started a JB show OnlyFans, and it was like pictures of like just all of our regulars. It was Matt on there, JB, me, all of our regulars. He will probably pay for it.
We should do a calendar. The three of us, Kim, the Coach JB show,
a big Smitty calendar. It's you, me, Steve, Kim, fucking Jeff, Smitty, Zach Smith,
Salisbury.
Hey, Big Matt in a firefighter my fucking suit dog. With a water hose on his shoulder.
Through my legs, holding it like,
Have me in the weight room and shit, curling my shirt off and shit.
Hey, Matt, I got my pit bulls like this.
With fucking cigar in your mouth, just wearing a robe, dick hanging out, just like,
What was Steve Kimmy doing? See, look, there you go. Lucy, you buy it. I knew Lucy with
the Coach fucking Smitty calendar or the Coach JB calendar.
JB, hey, what was Steve
naked?
What was Steve Kimmy doing in the calendar, JB?
Huh?
I said, what would Steve be doing in the counter, Steve Kim?
Oh, fuck. He had boxing gloves on, naked, with a fucking in a ring.
Just like two boxing gloves and then one boxing glove on his cock.
Like why don't we just have the fucking playmate version? Why we just can't have the pit bulls? Matt has the bag, the six-year-old.
It's funnier when you're naked.
Smitty's got a fucking big old smile and a fucking wife beater and a goddamn
you can dress Smitty up like the Adam 22 dude and he can just go. He can just walk in and be like, hey, I'm here for the audition.
Hey, I just walked in.
How we doing?
Hey, Smitty, we're gonna have Jeff Nadeau and Gronk's dad, baby Gronk.
What? Yes, yes. How about they're gonna be wrestling? They're wrestling match.
Jeff Nadeau and baby Gronk on the calendar. Oh, front
dude, this would be fucking incredible. God damn.
Oh, fuck. Hey, oh. Hey, Smitty. How long I got you? 10 minutes, Matt?
Sure.
All right. Let's get into something real quick. Hey, Ethan, pull up. I want to get Matt's opinion on and Smitty. Hey, Matt, I want to get your top five Super Bowl contenders.
Oh, I like this.
Oh, shoot.
Okay, in no particular order. I'll just
pull mine up. Ethan, pull mine up. Wake up, Ethan!
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 Ethan! Number one is the Jets. Oh, I like this, coach. I dig this. all right, so in no particular order, I'm gonna go Kansas City, the Eagles, the Jets. Kansas City, the Eagles, the Jets, the Lions, and the Niners.
Lions.
Yeah, I think the Lions are going to be fucking good, bro. Like, I think Jared Goff's the perfect quarterback for that place. He's under the radar. He had a great year last year. He doesn't need to be the LA badass and all the eyes on me. That's not really him. And, you know, that guy had a lot of shit talked to him. Like, he couldn't play. And he's the number one overall pick who started a Super Bowl. He's far from a chump. I think he's going to be really motivated. I love Dan Campbell. I think they're doing the right thing in Detroit. I think they're going to run away with that division.
I just don't know about the Lions defense, if they can get through the gauntlet.
They probably can. I'd imagine that. I think they'll host a playoff game and win one and then probably run into somebody in the division round or in the championship round that probably puts 40 on them. And that's true. Man,
I got to be all the people in the chat and everybody out there that don't have a fucking clue what I'm talking about. The reason I have the Seahawks in there and the Jets, because I have them in the Super Bowl, which I've already stated. So I have Jets, to have them in my top five, you fucks.
And you're not wrong. I mean, look, let's be real here. There's no right or wrong answer here. It's an opinion question. But it's definitely not wrong. Like, the Seahawks are really, really fucking good. And Geno Smith is the perfect quarterback for them. They got better when they got rid of Russell Wilson. So, you know, the Jets are fucking loaded.
I try to tell people they think I'm fucking crazy or something. I don't know.
If they stay healthy, Aaron, I work with McGovern and Billy Turner. They're both two of my guys that I've been working with forever. McGovern's the starting center. Billy Turner is rotating at guard and tackle, and he's one of their swing guys. He'll probably start a bunch of games for him. I was talking to them last night, and they are like, it is night and day change. Robert Saleh is just sitting there fucking, like, literally, like, counting his guys. Like, oh, my God, I got another one. There's pass rushers falling out of the ceiling. Quinnen Williams is the best three technique in football. Yes, that's what I said. Better than Aaron Donald. Quinnen Williams is better than Aaron Donald right now.
Chris Jones?
And, yeah, way better than Chris Jones. Chris Jones don't play the run. Chris Jones is a pass rusher. Chris Jones ain't playing no run game. I respect Aaron Donald because he plays the run, too. Like, if you're a three technique and you can't play first and second down, then you don't deserve to rush the passer on third down. That's just my opinion. And I think
here's Big Smitty's, Big Matt. Here's Big Smitty's Super Bowl contenders.
I like this, too. Other than all these Charger picks, why the Chargers, guys?
I got to pick them eventually. I think their roster's loaded.
I'm a big Justin Herbert fan, man. I get they haven't really – they ain't won a playoff game yet. I get it. But I think this is going to be the year.
Guys, they're the Chargers. Like, it's like the Clippers, huh? You can talk about all this shit all you want. And, like, they got Mac and Bosa, and they got fucking Darwin. They got dude.
Derwin James. Hey, they got Eric Kendricks now.
And then you have to remember they're the fucking Chargers, and they're immediately going to shit on themselves.
Hey, Matt, if Frisco don't make it, Big Smitty's going to have the Bengals play the Chiefs in the Super Bowl.
No, the point of why I made this is the AFC is loaded this year. The AFC is way better than the NFC. Obviously, I'm like, duh. Like, my number six pick would be the Eagles. Yeah, that would be next if I put number six.
All AFC.
Hey, man, AFC's rolling, man.
Will say this, though. I really hope that one day the NFL reseeds 1 to 16 or 1 to 14 rather than AFC-NFC, because I do think that there's a lot of circumstances where the two teams in the NFC title game are way fucking better than the two teams.
Exactly.
Like, you remember when, you remember year 2000, Baltimore, New York Giants? Like, the Giants shut out the Vikings 41-0 in the NFC title game.
Yeah.
The Ravens beat the Titans for the third time that year. That was a great game. But the Super Bowl should have been Ravens-Titans. Like, they were by far the best two teams in football. So I would love to see that in basketball and football, where they just get you. If you make the playoffs, you're in the playoff seating. The top two records get a bye. Everybody else, we just seed you from 3 to 14, and we fucking roll. And if the third seed is Kansas City and the 14th seed is the Lions, there's your game.
Yeah,
hey, man, I got something to say. I want to get something off our chest while I have you, because Smitty and I were going to break this down, because I'm taking so much heat on internet right now.
Why?
I've made my AFC and NFC predictions. I don't think people understand what predictions mean. I don't think they realize that I'm not fucking Nostradamus and I'm sitting here picking these teams to be an exact science. I get that I have teams not winning certain amount of games or having them winning too many games. When you predict something, Matt, let these people know out here in this world that usually you give a plus or minus 2, because we're not sitting here calling out that this is an exact science. I'm giving you plus minus 2 to every prediction we have ever seen. That's why there's plus and minus in betting. So I'm trying to figure out, everybody blowing me up about my predictions, understand, if I have the Colts at 7 wins, meaning they probably will win 5 or they could win more. But right now, I think they're going to win less right now, especially.
Yeah, the Colts are, I think their future is bright, but I don't think they're going to be any good next year.
Me either. Let me have it, Matt. Go ahead. Now, this is with Burrow being healthy, of course.
I like this. I love this. This is the way I would pick it. And I think Baltimore is going to be better than Pittsburgh. But I think the Chargers, I don't have the Chargers in the playoffs, but my playoff teams are Cincy, Baltimore, the Chiefs. The Broncos were in there before I went to training camp, and now they're not. They're out. So the Chiefs out of the West, and then I'm taking the Jets, the Bills, the Jags. Oh, fuck. And then, I don't know. I would say Cleveland. I'm really eager to see if Deshaun Watson and Cleveland can do what they should do, because they have a great offensive line. Deshaun Watson is a great play-action quarterback, and Nick Chubb is a fucking hammer. And Stefanski is a good coach, and their defense isn't terrible. And at some point, the Browns are going to meet their potential, right? I mean, that's a playoff team with Baker Mayfield. Deshaun Watson's a better player than him. He's a worse person, but a better player. I will say this, though. Life is weird. I was on Instagram like last night, and I got a DM from some chick that does massages. 3 seconds into it, she's like, "You want a tug?" And I'm like, "What the fuck?" It's weird, dude. I was like, "Oh, Deshaun's people are reaching out to me. This is bad. Block, block, block this bitch. Block this bitch."
Hey, look.
You're getting me, motherfucker. You're not getting me.
Hey, and look at this. The Chiefs could be 12-5 easily. So the Broncos could be 8-9 easily.
Timeout.
So
the fucking Chiefs being 10-7. Explain yourself.
Well, I mean, I've already gotten into all this. Here's the deal. Here's the deal, Matt.
Here it comes. Wait, Freddie, wait.
Matt, can you please let everyone know, in all seriousness, know if Chris Jones is not a Chief, they're losing 2 more games.
Oh, well, he's going to be guaranteed. I guarantee you they pay him.
But understand something. I'm saying right now, these are predictions right now. Maybe before the season, I correct some of them. But if Chris Jones don't play, Matt, there are going to be a lot of scoring going to have to occur with a brand new wide receiver crew and a brand new. I mean, I get their O-line's good. I understand they're good, but they are new, and I want to see it. You know how hard it is to win a back-to-back Super Bowl, and everyone's headhunting after you. They want to knock you down.
I don't think they're going to repeat. I don't even think they'll get there, but they'll host a playoff game.
Well, like, that's all they've ever done. Mahomes has never played a road playoff game yet.
And he probably ain't playing one this year. Like, look, I think Mahomes is outside of the box when it comes to the way the quarterback position is played. but he is revolutionizing the way the quarterback position is played also. And I think he's elite, and I think him and Kelsey are the same as Montana and Rice and Young and Rice. I can put dudes around those two, and they're going to be fucking superstars. Like, put give me John Taylor and Burt Jones and fucking Roger Craig, and you give me Montana and Rice, and we're winning Super Bowls. You take away Montana and Rice, and those three are just guys. I'm sorry, but it's what it is.
Hey, Ethan, bring up the NFC for Matt. Let us see the NFC, Matt. Here's my NFC. I think the NFC
Bears.
Obviously, we know they're worse.
You're high off your ass if you think.
He got the Bears winning 10 games, Matt. Last year they won 3 games. Think about that.
And they can win 8 games. I think they are going to win 5 games better. They're going to be better 5 games by far. They're going to be 5 games better than they were last year.
I think everybody in the North other than Detroit is going to have a losing record.
We're on the same page, I think, in the North. I think they're really average. That's why I put them like that.
Yeah, that's true. It's a very average division. That's why I think Detroit's going to
win. And I think Green Bay is going to fall off the planet Earth.
Jordan, no love.
Yeah. I like the Seahawks, man. I don't love the 49ers quarterback situation. I blame Lynch and Shanahan. I'm continuing to blame them. He has altered a great roster year in and year out, and you have to have a superstar quarterback on that roster.
We could argue that San Francisco has been the best team in the league for the last 6 or 7 years, and they've only made one Super Bowl and lost.
That's what I'm saying.
If they would just look at themselves in the mirror, and they tried to solve the problem. They traded a bunch of people to draft Trey Lance. He sucks. He can't fucking play, obviously, or they wouldn't be stacking the deck with Darnold and Purdy and all these other kids. Now, look, Purdy stepped in last year and was excellent, but they didn't have tape on him.
Exactly.
They have a whole offseason on him now. They got a book on him now. They know what he struggles with. They're going to watch what happened in Philadelphia and mimic that and just do it over and over again to him. So I would want to test that elbow. If I'm on defense, I'm going after his throwing arm immediately when we play. And that's not dirty. That's football. If you have an ankle problem on the injury report, I'm going to make sure that I'm rushing that side of your body constantly as a defensive player. So if the 49ers, like Aaron Rodgers was available this year and they didn't fucking do everything humanly possible to get him. If Aaron Rodgers played quarterback for the San Francisco 49ers, I might pick them to be undefeated.
Oh, yeah, it would be scary. Oh,
like, I think that they would just run. I think they would run through the NFL like shit through a fucking goose, bro. Like, they've got They have the best tackle I've seen since Walter Jones and Trent Williams. They have a world-class fucking running back in Christian McCaffrey, who I think is an unbelievable fucking player that I have watched play since he was a freshman at Valor High School right next door to my house. Literally every game this kid plays, I try and watch because he's so electric. Brandon Ayuk is a stud. Debo Samuel is a fucking revolutionary player at his position that can run the ball, catch the ball, do everything. I bet you could play safety if you asked him to. Their defense is fucking loaded. Fred Warner is that dude. He's like a missile to the football. Bosa is an animal. I mean, they got fucking defensive linemen for days. The three technique is Armstead, right?
They got Eric Armstead. They just signed a guy from the Eagles.
Yeah, the dude from the Eagles. They stole the dude from the Eagles, him at nose tackle. He's a
Hargrave.
They got D-line like, is scary.
Their secondary's loaded. Like, they've done such a great job of just fortifying the whole team. And then you go look at the quarterback room, and it's fucking Trey Lance and Sam Darnold and Brock Purdy, and you're like, what the fuck? This doesn't make any sense. How can they be so good in every other aspect and fuck this up so bad?
And that's what leads me to the Eagles. I think that Hurts is going to have a sophomore slump for the most part because of the catalog that's now on him from the pocket versus him running. We have a full catalog on Jalen Hurts. Is it improved? Yes, he has improved. I like what he's done. But I do think DCs are going to prep him a little different this year. I understand he has two great wideouts and a good tight end. He still has a great O-line. I think that losing the guys they lost on defense, which people don't believe it's a big deal, is a bigger deal than people understand.
It's a massive problem.
You got young cats playing D-line in the NFL, and I haven't seen young guys really impact the game like that.
There's a reason they went out last year and signed Joseph and Sue in the middle of the season.
Yes.
They wanted to bring their Hargrave back. They couldn't afford him. But there's also a reason why they went out and drafted Dean and Davis and all these guys from Georgia. So now Jordan Davis, like, I know you look like Tarzan, but at times you play like Jane. Like, he's a fucking big son of a bitch, and he destroys shit. But you play, if he plays against a world-class center and guard, he disappears. He gets his ass beat because those people play with leverage and power and pressure. He's used to people folding underneath him because he's just bigger and better. So now he's got to figure out how to really play the nose tackle position in the NFL, which is a fucking man's game. I mean, that is that there is no ifs, ands, or buts about this, bro. If you put your hand down in the trench in an NFL game and you're playing guard, center, nose tackle, or three technique, you are a fucking animal. You're an animal. Because though that is the, in my opinion, it's the most physically demanding job in the entire world.
Thank you.
Like, I look, I'm not talking about mentally demanding. The quarterback has the hardest job in the world. But you want to tell me a guy, I played both ways. These are my positions: three technique, nose tackle, center, and both guards. That's all I ever played in games my whole life. It is the most physically demanding position, those five positions, in the fucking history of football. Period. And I'll take the fucking Pepsi challenge with anybody that wants to say different.
I agree with you. And I would even add that from the mental standpoint, not from like a brainiac, but like sometimes when you're going through hell physically, yeah, it pays a toll on you mentally. Sometimes, you know what I mean?
Fucking drains on guys constantly.
Exactly. You like, gotta
in the first quarter, you like playing guard, I can look at a defensive lineman and go, okay, this guy's gonna bring it. Like, I'm gonna be in a fight today. And then by the end of the third quarter, especially like if it's hot or shitty outside or the ground's bad or we're winning. If something bad happened, a lot of guys will start looking at the ground and like you can tell that they're tired and they're walking back to the huddle and shit. That's blood in the water for me, bro. Like I tell everybody I work with all the time, imagine how tired you are right now. Now imagine how tired your competition is that's sitting at home playing with himself or eating chocolate chip pancakes that mommy just made while you're in here struggling and fucking and striving for greatness and he's sitting at home. Imagine how fucking tired he's going to be when you're this tired. So, you know, I think fatigue makes cowards of all men. And yes, the harder you can play when you're tired, the better you're going to be.
I love the people that don't listen when we say 2+, 2-. Everyone's still telling me.
Hey, I'm going to give you some advice as your friend. Something that I do every day. I never read comments. Like, I know you do.
I was telling JB the other day, we had a conversation. I said, JB, I said, just ignore them. Like, they literally know you know.
I need to do it. So, you know what it does for me? You know what it does for me, Matt? It keeps me off of this at 7 a.m.
Well, yeah, that's probably a good idea
too. Why is it not full then?
You can't drink at 7 a.m.
I drank it last night.
Unless you're going from last night to the morning, then I guess that's acceptable.
I'm the man of the people, man. I gotta fucking talk shit.
Hey, shit, man. If you're doing that, I'm doing this. Everything's everything. We're good.
Hey,
I'm in Denver. Fuck y'all. I can do whatever I want. Smoke.
I'm in LA. I can technically if I wanted to. You know,
do your thing. You go out in the street and get some crack. They'd be like, here, have some crack.
I saw some homeless dude the other day doing that. Literally.
No, I don't give a fuck. Like, California is the fuck it place now. Fuck it.
Hey, where's that, Ethan? Where's that that Dion thing? Here it is right here, Matt. Let's play this.
Asked it right now. Here's why. Kormani McClain said that he threw up seven times after a Colorado practice. And people are worried that Coach Prime is abusing these kids. College football practices have become way too brutal. Back in March, Gentry Williams was hospitalized after an Oklahoma workout. And Jahmyr Gibbs said that Nick Saban has his players in full pads in the heat for 2 hours. I know it's football, but these are still just kids. Is winning games really that important? Yes.
All right,
Who is this guy in the video? He knows nothing about football. I mean, bro, zero.
I commented on this, and I all I wrote was like, "Wow, this is the softest."
You got it first, Matt. Go.
And bro, like, look, this is why I don't read comments. This is why I don't read comments, because this is what it is. It's dudes in the comment section that are like, "Well, why is my fantasy team doing good?" And fuck, man, I lost my bet and. But I don't want these kids to go out in the sun and pads. They might throw up, and then somebody's going to cry, and it's going to get emotional, and we're going to have to get a comfort dog. Fucking college football ain't for you, motherfucker. College football isn't for you. It's not for you. We will eat you fucking alive. You need to go be a tennis fan or some shit. And probably those guys are too tough for you too, because that shit is pretty hard. This kind of shit is so detrimental to football because there's some idiot mom or idiot dad out there that agrees with this. That's like, you're right. It is too hard. It is too hot. They aren't. I can't believe Coach Prime said that he threw up seven times. He made him throw up. Oh my God. He threw up because he's out of fucking shape. He threw up because he's never been pushed before, because he's a five-star recruit and everybody's been patting him on his fucking back his whole life. And now he got to Boulder and instead of getting a blowjob, he had to go fucking run. And now he's tired and he had to puke and it's a wake-up call. You're not as good as you think you are, homeboy. Get to fucking work. That's the way this game works, man. I really, it's not for everybody. And some of y'all, we don't want you involved. You need to go away.
100%, man.
Go ahead, Smitty.
Now, football is hard. Football is tough. Like, if I trained you to be soft, then we're gonna be a shitty ass football team. So practices, from my experiences, were a lot harder than games because they had to be. I had to mentally get prepared, physically be prepared to go to war. And I'm not trying. I'm not trying to compare it to the actual, but you get what I'm saying. Like, those battles on Saturdays or Sundays is crucial. And I can't coach up a soft team. It can't be just fucking positive environment and happy. It has to be stress. Feelings.
It can't be exactly. Feelings motivated. Like, your feelings are important and your mental stability is important. And if you're struggling, we will help you. But your feelings on the important list, if there's 10 things, your feelings are 12. Like,
right.
I don't give a fuck how you feel, dog. We're in training camp. Everybody is miserable.
All right, here we go. Let me get the old man on the porch yelling at the clouds.
Get off my lawn!
I heard the first thing out of this fucking Asian guy's mouth. No offense.
What difference does it make if he's Asian?
It does matter because I don't know any Asians that play in the fucking NFL.
Yes,
or
you do. Yangwon Koo, Atlanta Falcons, one of the best kickers. Stop.
That win.
I'm racist. All right, here we go.
Racist.
Here we go.
Cancel. Here we go.
All right.
I love you.
Here we go. This motherfucker, out of his first sentence, said that these kids, quote, kids, are out there for 2 hours. They're still kids playing a game. Now, that is what he said. And I have one question to ask you, Matt, and I'm going to drop the mic on this. Are they kids? They're not kids when they're coming in there demanding for 300 fucking grand to play, motherfucker. They're grown men and professionals. The last time I checked, it's professional fucking football now. They're not kids anymore once you start paying them. Shut the fuck up and go play tennis, motherfucker.
100%, man.
Mic drop. No. And that is what it is these days. And unfortunately, everybody gets a platform to talk about this shit. And you know what? Like, that guy that made that video, it went viral. We're talking about it on the show. He's happy. He doesn't give a fuck. He just gets up there and spews garbage and it gives somebody something to react to. It's like, I saw this video 2 weeks ago or something, and I actually tagged Vaughn and Trent Williams on it. And these guys talking about if you wear sleeves, you're a shitty player in the trench. And I'm like, well, Trent Williams and Vaughn Miller wear sleeves every game. They're like, two first ballot Hall of Famers, so that's dumb as fuck. But that's just to get clicks. So
yeah, exactly. And the last time I checked, we used to teach putting sleeves on certain people so you don't get fucking grabbed. It's not sweaty. It's slippery. It keeps your hands. It slips right up the sleeve. It slips down. There's a reason we put Vaseline on pads. Get your fucking ass from fucking grabbing my ass, you soft pussy.
Y'all know what? I actually blame us for this. I blame us because you just alluded to it, Matt. We shouldn't even be acknowledging this slap dick for saying this. He doesn't know a thing about football at all. And by us talking about him and bringing him up, we're adding to his fan base, his follower. He loves this right now.
That's what we have a show for, because if we wouldn't have anything to talk about if it wasn't for these slapdicks. And I got to be honest, we're really out here defending Prime, if we want to be honest. Fuck this guy.
Well, yeah. I mean, look, he's wrong. And I've been in huddles and thrown up on my shoes. And
I agree with Smitty.
Like, I've had people throw up on me before. I've thrown up and put my hand in it and ran the play. Like, dog, we're men. This is a man's game. Yeah. I'm sorry if there's blood and fucking guts on the ground. Do your fucking job. That we're not. This isn't the Barbie movie.
Hey, you know how many times I've seen like stars and like black dots because I'm thinking like I'm about to fucking pass out numerous times. Trust me, numerous times.
Ethan, last thing before Matt gets out of here, Ethan, drop that video of Dak Prescott getting called a bitch.
Bitch.
And then he waited to separate and he threw the ball. He flicked the ball at him.
All right, there's a few things. I got to get Matt's take on this, Matt. A few things that you can take from this. I'm going to give you the coach's perspective after I get your player perspective on this. Turn coach. Please give me that one.
Okay, so as a defensive player, if I were ever to look at the starting quarterback who's established in practice on camera and call him a bitch twice, that probably means that I don't respect him at all, and I think we're going to lose because of him. As an offensive player, as a guard center, if there's somebody over here calling my quarterback a bitch and he does it twice and then continues to talk shit, why is the offensive line not on top of Trey Diggs right now beating the motherfucking life out of him? Why is he not being picked up and DDT'd?
Yeah,
like, why are we not just having a training camp fight? Like, bro, where's the offensive line? Like, you're going to call him? Yes, he's a bitch. We know. But you don't get to call him a bitch.
That's my first.
You don't get to call him a bitch. You can call him a bitch behind his back, but you can't call him a bitch to his face. Not while I'm here. So, look, I think the Cowboys are loaded with the exception of quarterback. Another team that didn't go after Aaron Rodgers. Oh, like fucking morons. So, I think the Cowboys will be just good enough to make the playoffs and fucking lose again. Because Dak Prescott is not the guy, bro. And everybody will know after this year, he's gonna pad stats against shitty teams. And the minute he gets into a situation where he's got to win a game with his arm, he's gonna shit all over himself or get hurt and it's over.
Go ahead, Smitty.
Nah, I mean, shoot, I think he hit the nail right on the head. Like, as football guys, we know that your quarterback is the leader of your team, and he's the guy that's protected by his O-line, by his squad. So the fact that no O-lineman was there, and again, I don't know. I had to see the play again. He might have ran into the end zone. Maybe the O-lineman just wasn't around when, you know, and they didn't hear it. I don't know. There's a lot of different factors that goes into it. But nevertheless, I know when I played in my first 2 years at Ball State, we had a quarterback named Keith Winning who ended up getting drafted in the sixth round. He's a backup for a couple years in the league, I think for the Bengals. He was a guy, though, in college. He was a bad man. We would never – none of us would ever call him a bitch. Never. Like, we would trash talk. We would compete, of course, the football player. But I'm not calling him a bitch. Like, because I respect him too much.
That's prison yard shit right there. That's – you're a fucking bitch to see if you're going to do anything. And he called him a bitch twice and then walked off and Dak kind of threw the ball at him. Like, yeah, I am a bitch. Take the ball.
Mm. I mean, there's so much to unravel here, Matt.
He's a bitch. He can't help it.
I don't even know where to start. KD demanded a trade because Draymond Green called him a bitch. Don't forget, number one. Number two.
KD is a bitch.
Yeah. Number two, you think Troy Aikman would have been called a bitch by a corner in ever?
No. I think Larry Allen would have ate someone if they called Troy Aikman a bitch.
This is the call.
It never would have happened. Ever.
This guy just got a $100 million deal, Trayvon Diggs, who he'll get 6 or 7 picks, but he'll give up 6 or 7 bombs over the top of Baghdad eat too. He got a big old bag.
Bombs now, over he's Diggs. The shit. Head.
Now he's the shit, right? Now he's the shit. This is clearly a major statement that this team will once again be absolute shitty.
Shit.
Because they do not respect the guy at the helm, and it's clear as day. And if I don't hear about today Diggs having his ass whipped in the locker room by the O-line, then I know that team is fucked. Because I'll give you the pass of Smitty's comment. They didn't hear it. They don't know anything. Well, it's a viral video now. They fucking know today.
Oh, yeah.
I better see somebody whip that ass in the locker room today or at least have a fight crack off.
There better be a fight at training camp today. Somebody better go after Diggs.
Fucking right.
Otherwise, like, you could go make T-shirts and put Diggs to say,
the guy that should go after him, to be honest, is some type of receiver or tight end, because your fucking ass knows the deal and what happened. And we know the O-line will absolutely murder the kid. Let's go fucking go get him with a tight end or a wideout. Double team the motherfucker on a POA block or something. Go fucking start some shit.
CeeDee Lamb needs to go fucking lay a shoulder on this dude.
This team looks like absolute fucking a mockery once again. And I'm tired of hearing ESPN, all these fucking people picking them over and over and over, when the clear problem is your quarterback. And this will be the end of the head coach and the quarterback this year.
I bet you McCartney is fired by week 8.
Well, wouldn't be shocked. Did y'all see that video too? I don't think we have it. Micah, people were talking about this yesterday. Micah Parsons was doing the pass rush.
Holy shit.
He gave him up and under, and he fell right in front of Dak's legs. And everybody, got nervous and blaming Micah Parsons for going too hard. But he actually got pushed in the back.
He just whipped Tyron Smith's ass.
I said blame Smith for not fucking blocking him.
I mean, come on, dog. I mean, sometimes tackles get beat. Micah Parsons is a fucking animal.
Yeah, that's a fact.
All right, I got to go to training camp, so I'm going to go watch Russell Wilson suck some more. Have a good day.
Hey, send me a video and just say, fuck you, Russell Wilson, motherfucker! And I want to see the video. I'll reshare it.
No, I'm going to go hit on Sierra and put it on video and see what happens.
Hey, it's in your future,
Mark.
Russ isn't going to do anything.
Hey, it could be in your future.
Just...